Okay. Well, here we are again. So I wanted to show you all, for those of you who do the website thing, exactly where, if you miss a week, if you get behind, this is exactly where it is. And you know what? I didn't put the, hold on. Y'all bear with me, dude. Who is it?
We're just a baron.
Yeah. There we go. That's the website, philosministries.com. And if you go over to learn, and this is still under construction, I think I've showed some of you my cards. Who hasn't seen them? I think everybody's seen them, right? I hand these out. You guys haven't seen them.
I hand these out. Okay. Have you seen them? Oh, sorry. Have you seen them?
No, ma'am.
Oh, I'm not giving her that one, too. I don't know.
Y'all seen these?
I think you gave them a different one last week.
Yeah, that's just one of the ones.
You only had the business card.
That's what we pass out. When I go walking, I leave them around, and when we go to a restaurant, we put them in there with the check. The guy at Joe's Crab Shack got one today. So.
Happy anniversary.
Thank you. So this is where the website, and this is where you go Sunday nights, and you'll see it linked. It'll be in there. So real quick, some announcements. So we still need help with the prayer teams. We really, really do. I'll talk to Julie about re-announcing hers. But I really ask all of you on Sunday morning to just toss it up to the Lord and say, you know, after we're done with announcements, do you want me to stay here or do you want me to go pray? Okay? And allow the Lord to lead you. Because, praying is a blessing. So
how many did you have this morning? I didn't even ask.
It was just me. Yeah. But that's okay. If that's what the Lord wants to do, then that's what the Lord's going to do. Women's safety course, 7 o'clock tonight. 7 o'clock Thursday. So you know where it's going to be, whereabouts?
In the sanctuary.
In the sanctuary.
But it's not just for women. Everyone's welcome.
Okay.
Women's ministry is sponsoring.
I'm going to be there because I'm a victim advocate for sexual assault and domestic violence. I'm certified through a national organization called NOVA. And it's one of my other military hats is I act as a victim advocate for mostly women, but also men who are victims of sexual assault. Because believe it or not, sexual assault, male-on-male sexual assault is actually a big deal in the military. So as scary as that sounds, as bad as that is, and it's something that's been going on. It's not a recent development. That stuff was happening in Vietnam. It was happening in Korea. It's just nobody talked about it. And people carried that stuff to their grave, and it destroyed their lives. So that's part of what I do is I'm a victim advocate. For domestic violence and sexual assault. So announcements, we're doing our evangelism course. It will be at our house. Anybody who wants to join, just let us know. It'll be at 6:30 on Tuesday evenings. That'll be Tuesdays. So if you want to learn how to share your faith, be a little bit more confident in sharing your faith, just let me know that you want to be a part of it. So real quick, we want to review. Best way to learn what the meaning of the Bible is saying. Give me somebody shout out one. If I really want to take a passage of scripture and really understand what it's saying, not just the surface level thing that we can get 99% of the time, but if I really want to get deep into the message, there's three things that I need to look at. What are they? Say it again.
The original text. What it was.
The original text. Looking at the grammar of the Greek. Because, matter of fact, since we got time, somebody open to John 21. I need somebody to read here. And some of you have made heard a sermon this way. Not a sermon this way, but a sermon on this. But just in case, John 21. And I would like somebody to read starting in verse 15. And go through 19.
Well, mine's different from everybody else's Bible. Like, I've noticed when y'all read the Bible,
what version is yours?
I don't know if Julie gave it to me.
Okay, does somebody have the King James Version or the ESV?
She's got the Hungry.
Okay, would you read the King James Version? I know you went to Sweeney, so that's probably a problem. Oh, okay.
You said 15 through 19.
Yes, ma'am.
Jesus said unto her,
John 21. John 21, verse 15. That's all right.
So when they had dined, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He said unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my lambs. He saith to him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He said unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He said unto him, Feed my sheep. He said unto him the third time, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, Lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus said unto him, Feed my sheep.
Okay, that'll work right there. Okay, so why is Peter grieved? Why is Peter now grieved?
Because he kept asking.
Okay, is that
blame me?
Okay, so that's what you take from that. Okay, on the surface, that is a very excellent explanation. On the surface, but if you get into the Greek, you get a better explanation. And let me explain. In English, we have one word for love. Love. I love the Cowboys. I love my wife. You have to know the context in order to know that I just am really a big Cowboys fan, or that I'm deeply, madly in love with my wife. But in Greek, it's not so. So let me show you what happens here. Simon, son of John, this is ESV. Do you love me? So here's Jesus. He says, do you agape me? That is godly, sacrificial love. Now, it's a little bit of a misnomer to say agape means godly love, because in the original Greek, when the Greeks were using that word on the street in Athens, they weren't saying, I got godly love, because that wasn't what they're... It's a self-sacrificing love. All right, it puts your needs before mine. That's agape. Here's what Peter says. He said to him, yes, Lord, you know I love you. But that's not what he said. He said, yes, Lord, you know I phileo you. I'm your friend. See the difference? Jesus asked, you love me in a self-sacrificing way. And basically Peter said, yeah, you're my buddy. It'd be similar to Vanessa saying, do you love me? And I say, yeah, I'm very fond of you. Guys, is that a good thing or a bad thing? Let's do the old Roman way. Is that this or that? That's that, right? Okay, so here he says again, Simon Peter. Second time. So this is the first time. Second time. Simon Peter, do you love me? Agape me. Do you agape me? And Peter said to him, yes, I phileo you. Again. Third time. Jesus changes words. He doesn't say, a third time, do you agape me? He says, do you phileo me? See what the difference? Mm-hmm. So that's what actually grieved Peter. Is Jesus had been saying, are you a self-sacrificing lover of me? And Peter says, you are buddy. And Jesus said again, are you a self-sacrificing lover of me? And Peter said, you are buddy. And finally, Jesus replied, so I'm a buddy. And that's what sunk him deep in. That's what grieved him, was Jesus had switched up the words on him. And he says, basically, all I am to you is a friend. And that's when he broke. So, therein lies the reason why, to the best of your ability, you need to get into the grief. I remember where I was when I discovered this. I was sitting at my little kitchenette table in my RV my senior year at A&M. And I remember I came across this, and it was a lesson. This was back in 1994, and it was a lesson for me to always go to the Greek, because this is a treasure here. Because your answers is right. And that's part of it. But unless you dig deeper, you can't really get the gist of exactly what's happening here. There's wordplay going on here. And Jesus is basically saying, so I'm your buddy. And Peter realized, no, you're not a buddy, you're Lord. Because remember what Peter had said, where are we going to go? You know, because Jesus said, are you going to desert me too? And Peter said, where are we going to go? You have the keys to salvation. You know, who do men say that I am? Well, they say this and that. Who do you say I am? You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And now Jesus says, so I'm just your buddy. And it finally caught Peter where he was. And he said, no, that's not true. And that's what grieved him. So that is the importance of getting into the grammatical structure. And also, like we looked at last week, when we looked at the very fact that the way the moods and the tenses were, it showed that it could be an action that was going on right now, but not necessarily carrying into the future. See, that's the beauty of the Greek language. And some of you have probably heard this preached, that the Greek language was the most perfect tool to carry God's word. It's the most perfect language ever in existence. And there's a reason why people say it's Greek to me. Everybody heard that expression? My first semester of Greek class, I immediately knew why they said that, because I thought, this is crazy stuff. When I've got a word to loosen, okay, lelousa, that is the verb, when you take it through all the tenses and the texts and the moods and the genders, you have to memorize basically about 27 different words. Because just like in Spanish, y'all know how you just almost, or you add little words on the end, you got a root and you just add one. That works sometimes in Greek, but sometimes it changes. The whole word is changed. But it's that way because you can speak something and it's just, you change one little syllable, you change one little letter, and it changes the whole text. Okay? So that's the first thing, is know that original language. So, what's the second? What's another thing? We need to know the Greek. Uh-oh, honey.
Sorry.
That's all right. We need to know the Greek. What else do we need to know?
We need to know the Bible.
Okay, that's true. But there's something deeper than that.
The
context, right. And that's kind of what you were saying. That's what you're saying. You need to know the context. First of all, you can't take a scripture out of context. Okay? If I were to tell you Jesus wept, but I didn't keep it in context and you have never heard that before, would you know why Jesus was weeping? But because you know the context, why was Jesus weeping? Lazarus had died. His friend Lazarus had died. So that's the reason why you have to know the context. You have to know the context of where it sits in the scripture, what's going on before and what's going on after. But you also have to know the people. So if I'm sitting on a bank and I'm listening to Aramaic or Greek and I'm sitting on the side there and I've got the context of the original language, you know, certain things mean something to us that may not have meant something to them. And I've used that'll work. And I've used this illustration before. But husband of one wife in 1 Timothy 3. In the original Greek, it literally means a one-woman man. All right? We have taken that in our culture to mean not divorced. In the original context of the Ephesus church, which is where Timothy was receiving it, and on Crete, which is where Titus was receiving the same instruction, because it says both of those, and the Greek phrase is mies gunaikos aner, and that's not going to be on the quiz. Mies gunaikos aner, and that literally means one woman man. It means a man who's after his wife's heart. He is dedicated to the wife he has. And he has a pattern of that, being dedicated to the one he is married to. Because let's think about it. In Crete, they were raising up elders in every city. And they had only known the Lord on that island for 5 years. Before that, they were godless heathens. And even if you read in Titus chapter 1, you even see Paul talking about, this is what kind of people you are. You're a bunch of liars, you're filthy beasts, you're gluttons. And these things are true, he says. That's what they had come out of. And divorce in that culture was rampant. But what he's saying is, after you've come to Christ, this is your pattern. Okay? Because remember, 2 Corinthians 5:17 is, all things have passed away before. All things become new. So we got to know the context. We got to know what did the original hearers, when they heard that. Because it was when Paul wrote letters and Jesus said things, he was speaking it to first century people. He wasn't speaking it to 21st century people sitting in Rochelle. And so we have to sometimes know what they would have heard to really understand the meaning. Okay, so that's that. Know the context. And then what's the last one? The last one's kind of what the second one is a little bit.
Look at it through your own ideas.
Bingo. Yes, ma'am. Do not look at Scripture through your lens of your traditions. It is real easy to do. Okay, it's real easy, and I'm going to go somewhere that Baptists probably shouldn't go. But through our lens of tradition, we talk about drinking. Okay, let me tell you something. Up until about the last 2 centuries, everybody drank because you couldn't drink the water. It would kill you. How many people know why the Mayflower landed at Plymouth Rock? Who knows?
Why?
You know. Why did the pilgrims land at Plymouth Rock on the Mayflower? Why did they
lost control. They were drunk.
You're actually, it's the opposite. Now remember, these are pilgrims. These are Puritans.
Yes.
They ran out of beer. They ran out of beer. They ran out of alcohol. Because here's the thing. If you're on a long ship voyage back in the 14th, 15th century, you know what water turns into when you put it in a barrel. I've got 2 cisterns in the back that look like that. Okay? You can't take water and keep it in its pure form, and you're on the ocean, what are you going to do? So they had to put rum in it. That's why sailors drank rum. So when you look at Scripture, you know, Jesus turning the water into wine, you have to look in the context of the tradition, not the context of our lens. Okay? Some things hold true, but some things don't. All right? So you got to be real careful not to put your mental tradition, oh, well, this is the way it was interpreted in 1950. No. Okay? I want to know how it was interpreted back then. And that's the key. So, Miss Betty's on a roll today. You listen. Do not study through the lens. Okay. So, eschatological views. Let's, briefly, we're going to talk about the different ways you can look at Bible prophecy. There are actually 4 different ways to look at Bible prophecy, and 3 of which I believe are absolutely wrong. And I believe we can prove it, but how many of you have ever listened to the Bible Answer Man? Hank Hanegraaff. If you've listened to him talk about prophecy, you will know he is nowhere near where you are. Okay? He's just not. So the first is called preterism. Preterism. That means that the Bible, the book of Revelation that you have, it was actually fulfilled before 70 AD. They believe preterists believe that the book of Revelation was written for people before the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. And that everything that you see, the seal judgments, the dragon, the beast, all of those things happened either before or at 70 AD when Jerusalem was destroyed by the 10th Roman Legion, who were Arabs, by the way, not Romans, but that's for later. Now, there's a problem with that. The problem is that we are almost positive, because we look at some church historians who say it, that John wrote the book of Revelation in about 95 AD. So it's really hard to say that these are future prophecies of 70 AD when the book wasn't written until 25 years later. So you really got to stretch some things, and you have to really ignore some things. You've got to ignore some historical documents to believe in preterism. The next is historicism. Now, historicism teaches that the book of Revelation is fulfilled throughout Christian history. That some of these people, some of these Roman emperors, some of these popes, etc., is what the book of Revelation is talking about. But basically that it's already fulfilled, that the book of Revelation is a historical book filled of allegory. It's nothing to be taken literally, and there really isn't anything for you there today. That's false. The next is idealism. In other words, since we can't make heads or tails of this book, we're just going to say it's all symbolic. I don't know what it means, so therefore, since I can't figure it out, it must be symbology. And that's hokey. Finally, we have futurism. And what futurism teaches is that, yes, there are certain parts of the book of Revelation that are history. The first three chapters. And as we will see, Jesus even divided the book up. Write the things which you've seen. Write the things which are. So the things which were, the things which are, and the things which well shall be to come. And starting in chapter 4, that's all the future stuff. And John is told by Jesus, hey, this stuff is to come still. So in 95 AD, it was all still future for John. And as we go through this, you're going to see that it's probably mostly still future for us. So futurism, it is also what we call literally. We're taking the Bible literally. If it says it, we believe it. We don't have to concoct some kind of a strange, the red dragon must have, that was Domitian. That was this emperor, which there's no proof that we can say that. They just do that to make themselves feel better. Can you turn that air down? Just hit it about 10 times.
10 times?
I forgot to turn it on or turn it down.
Is it 75?
Yeah, turn it down about 62 and we'll turn it back up. So, in futurism, we have a couple of positions. More than a couple. We have about, there's really three. Amillennialism. So, how we can explain amillennialism is that there is no future reign of Christ. And how we get the millennial, that is the millennial reign of Christ right there. Okay? That's 1,000 years. 1,000-year reign of Christ. So, depending on what we do with this and where we put Jesus' return. Okay? Does Jesus return here? Does Jesus return here? Amillennialists teach that there is no 1,000-year kingdom, that it's all symbolic, which means you have to throw away a whole lot of the Old Testament. Isaiah 65. You have to throw away about 25% of the book of Ezekiel, because Ezekiel 40 through 48 and some other parts in Ezekiel are all about the millennial kingdom. And you will see all throughout the Old Testament, as you read the Old Testament prophets, you will see, and his kingdom shall be this, and they shall do this, and they shall do that. And it's talking about the kingdom, the 1,000-year reign of Christ. And so if we get rid of that, then you have to find an explanation for thousands of passages, or thousands of verses. You really do. Not only the 800 and something in Revelation, but there's a whole bunch in the Old Testament. Okay. Postmillennialism teaches that we'll have a 1,000-year reign, and basically the earth. Now, don't laugh when I say this, because This, up until World War I, this was the predominant view, right? The predominant view of most Christians, including many Baptists, all right? Most Protestant denominations were postmillennial, and this is what they believed, that the world would gradually get better and better and better and better and better. We would evangelize the world, and eventually we would usher in the kingdom. And then after we had 1,000 years of just good kingdom living, Jesus would come back. Now, with the way the world's going, do you guys see this as a possibility?
No. It didn't work out for
them. Didn't work out for them at all. Okay, World War I pretty much destroyed any idea of postmillennialism. So now you're stuck with being an amillennialist, which means you got to make everything kind of, you know, symbolic. Or you're stuck with what we call premillennialist. That is what we believe. Majority of us, I'm going to speak for all of you, but I'll say we, me. Premillennialist is that Jesus Christ physically comes back to the earth and sets up his 1,000-year kingdom. We have tons of Old Testament scriptures that we're going to look at over the course of this class. Because remember, anybody remember how many allusions there are in the book of Revelation to the Old Testament? 800. About 800. So if you don't understand Revelation, it's because your idea of the Old Testament is cloudy. And let's be honest. Most of us dwell in the New Testament. We don't spend a whole lot of time in the Old Testament. And it's kind of confusing. And the chapters are long. And, you know, we don't dwell there like we should. But if you can figure out what's the Old Testament saying, then it really gives you a lot of clues to plug in to figure out Revelation. Because there's 800 clues. So if you're trying to figure out a mystery and you've got 800 clues sitting somewhere, do you ignore that and try to do it on your own, or do you look at the clues? So you look at the clues. So premillennialism can be broken down into even, that can be broken down. And matter of fact, in the morning class, this is what we talked about today, the rapture of the church. Premillennialists believe in the second coming of Christ for his bride, but there's disagreements on when does that happen. Some believe it happens before the 7-year tribulation. They're known as pre-tribbers. I am a pre-tribber. I am not a staunch pre-tribber. I'm about a 90-95% pre-tribber. I'm also about a 5-10% mid-trib pre-wrath guy, which means that we actually go through the first 3.5 years of the tribulation, which isn't really that bad. There's some things that go on, but the great wrath of the Lamb, which is the sixth seal of Revelation, doesn't really come until here. All right, but the bride is taken away before that. And as we study the Church of Philadelphia, we'll see that's one of the promises for the Church of Philadelphia is I have kept you from the wrath to come. I will keep you out of that great tribulation. And so in this too, I should also say that there is a partial rapture theory. And partial rapture theory comes from that Church to Philadelphia letter. That letter to Philadelphia where he says, I have kept you out. Now, because we have 7 churches there. And we have, you know, the church of Smyrna is a good church. They don't have any condemnation to them. They're a good church, but they are not promised out to be kept out of the tribulation like Philadelphia is. And we know that Christians are inhabiting all of these 7 churches because as we study these letters, you're going to see Jesus is talking about, I know some of you are good and some of you are stinkers, but some of you are good. But he doesn't promise to keep them out. So perhaps there is a weeding out here that Jesus says, you know what, you're the church of Philadelphia, you aren't. And so there's a partial rapture where the Church of Philadelphia, quote unquote, if you fall into that category, you're taken out, and the rest of you get kind of tried by fire for a while. We'll look at that. This is where most of us fall. Pre-trib, premillennialism. So when you hear those words now you know what they mean. It basically means the pre-trib, the rapture of the church, occurs before the 7-year tribulation, and premillennialism means that Jesus comes before the kingdom is set up, before the millennial kingdom. So that's just, that's simple context there.
Nelson, I have something bothering me.
Okay.
I'm going to play devil's advocate.
Go for it.
Why do we care? I mean, I've been going to church for 60 years. I tried to read the book of Revelation, but I don't understand it. And we've got some people who, I mean, normal people are not going to know how to study this in the Greek and, mm-hmm. and to bring it all together.
Right.
And now you're saying that part of us are going to go in the rapture and part of us aren't.
Possibly.
It's yeah. like, you know, but we've been taught from the pulpit mm-hmm. in most churches, you give your life to Christ, you live a good life, you be righteous, you're going to go to heaven when Jesus comes and you're
right.
in the rapture and we're gone.
Right.
So and am I going to be accountable for not knowing?
No, you're not.
The content or?
And Betty, I think God just used you because the perfect setup. Okay, because you are right. I think I shared a brief testimony last week. What got me into Bible prophecy was when I gave my life to Christ, the very first book I read, and I was 12 years old, the very first book I read was The Late Great Planet Earth by Hal Lindsey. Being a student of the Word of God, I have commentaries covering my entire house. And I can tell you that as I go to those commentaries, there are a lot of godly people who have different opinions. And I want to state that for an absolute fact. I am not dogmatic about anything that's not essential. I'm not even dogmatic about you can lose your salvation or you can't. Because as we talked this morning, I can honestly see other people's opinions on some things. The rapture being one of them. And I'm not sold on the pre-wraths part. Like I said, I'm 95% pre-trib, and we're going to talk about why that is, why I believe that the Bible teaches that it has to be a pre-trib rapture, and it basically falls around Daniel chapter 9. And that's what we're going to learn. But to go back to your question, one of the things that all of this does and why you should care is because iron sharpens iron. I've had battles over the pre-trib, post-trib doctrine, and I have learned more sharpening my blade than if I had never had those battles, if I had never gone out into those. Believe me, I think when we first got married, you can look at her face too. When we first got married, I think she was wondering what the heck she had gotten into. Because you guys think I'm hard now, you should have seen me 18 years ago. Is that not the truth?
Yeah.
Okay. I was a young spitfire evangelist 18 years ago with not a whole lot of life experience, and I was very rigid, and I was willing to take a bull by the horns and go downtown. And I've really changed over the course of our marriage, and this woman has helped me. But what those early battles did is iron sharpened iron. I learned so much about God that I would have never known, and not just about the prophecy. I learned so much more because it caused me to dig and to study. And when I studied about that, I learned these things. You know what I mean? It's not just the one thing that I was studying. That's the way God works. You know, when you go into the Bible to look for something that maybe, it may not be prophecy related, it could be something else. You know, you're going to come out learning so much more about other stuff. And why it does matter is, you know what, table that question because it's in this lesson. I just remember. We're going to get to it. But to answer the first part of your question, you've heard it this way, you've heard it this way, you've heard it this way. Well, let me explain that it wasn't always that way. If we could take your 60 years and go back another 60 and go back another 60, people were hearing a totally different message. Remember about postmillennialism. You were hearing it post-World War I. But people pre-World War I were hearing something totally different. And it's because of this verse right here. Daniel 12:4. Daniel's like, he gets these visions, and he's so confused. And he's like, I don't get this. What does this mean? Lord, tell me. You've had me write this down, but tell me. And God says, nope, not going to do it. Go your way.
Nelson, just to add, and I kind of what we're studying, God put it there for a blessing.
And that's what we're going to talk about.
It's a blessing, but at the same time, it's something that we will never really understand this side of eternity.
Right.
So it comes down to Betty's point that God is fair. We can trust him. Mm-hmm. We don't have to know this.
No, you don't have to.
Know.
Yeah, and that's the thing.
Because God's going to be fair. We know that. We trust that.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And as I know I said it in the first class of our Sunday school class, but I want to say, in case I didn't say it last week, I want to say it now. Everybody that has ever stood in the pulpit, everybody that has ever taught a Sunday school class, everybody that has ever taught anyone anything as far as the Bible goes is a false teacher. Now that's a false teacher. Because let me tell you something, ain't nobody got it all right. And I guarantee you I have preached from the pulpit, and I have sat in classes for 20-something years, and there's some doctrine that I have taught that's not an essentialist, a non-essential thing, it's some little thing, that I have thought that the Bible said this, and I was wrong about it. So in a sense, in the technical definition of the word, I'm a false teacher. Now, there's a difference between false teaching and heresy. Heresy is a doctrine. Heresy is any teaching that, if you believe it, will cause you to not be saved. You cannot be saved believing this doctrine. One of the heresy is Jehovah's Witnesses, who teach that Jesus, he was not in existence before the cross. He was actually the Archangel Michael. And he transitioned to become Jesus. Okay, they do not believe that Jesus is part of the Godhead. So they deny who Jesus is. That's a heresy. Something about the rapture timing, that's a teaching. And not everyone has it all right. No one. And if you were to ask Daniel, can anybody here beat Daniel on their godliness? I can't. Anybody else? Anybody think they got Daniel beat? Okay. If somebody were to ask Daniel, hey, what do you think this means? He probably would have speculated. Well, maybe this and maybe that, blah, blah, blah. Guess what? Not even he knew. So it's okay to be ignorant when it comes to this stuff. But as we're going to learn, there's a reason why we do study it. And one of those is that iron sharpens iron. But we see here it says, Daniel, the words are shut up and sealed until the time of the end. In other words, the pulpits of 60 years ago, the pulpits of 200 years ago, the pulpits of 1,000 years ago, they could not understand it. Because God had sealed up the knowledge. Where do we get our... when you open your Bible, when you're at home, and God's... shows you something. How is he? What's the mechanism he's doing that through? What is he using? The Holy Spirit. If the Holy Spirit, you can sit here and read this all day long. And if the Holy Spirit is not actively involved in instructing you, you would think you're reading a recipe for, bread. Okay, because it's not going to make any sense to you. And many of you could probably look back at some point in your life when you read the scripture and you just never got anything out of it. You couldn't see anything. What is going on here? It's because you haven't invited the Holy Spirit to come in to your lesson and teach you. So the first thing you got to do when you're sitting there reading and you ain't getting nothing out of it, you better invite the Holy Spirit. He's the teacher. That's what Jesus said. In John 16 and 17, he said, hey, I'm going to send you a comforter. He's going to instruct you. He's going to teach you all these things. So and I've made a habit myself of every time I open that Bible, okay, Lord. And it's just a quick prayer, Lord. Proverbs 30, I said it last week, I said it today. I'm a brute. That's what it literally means. I am I'm too stupid to be a man is what the proverb says. Okay? That's Solomon. Solomon says he's too stupid to be a man. Okay? Well, it makes me feel real bad. Okay? But invite the Holy Spirit in. And so, since the Holy Spirit is not revealing knowledge, and this knowledge here is probably knowledge of what these prophetic scriptures mean. So, one of the reasons why we study it is because it proves itself. Because as we're going to see throughout this class, you're going to see some things that, Scripture, it proves that it's God's Word. Because who would have thought that Israel would have ever come back to be in a country after being exiled? And you know, the Bible taught it. And if you were studying Scripture before, you know, 1917, the Balfour Resolution, if you were studying Scripture, you knew that one day, hey, I don't know when, but the Bible says one day Israel's going to be a nation again. And mankind would have laughed at you. Whatever. Okay, sure. But the Bible said it. Was the Bible true? The Bible's true. The Bible said that Jerusalem was one day going to be the capital of Israel again. Pre-1967, people would have laughed at you. But what happened? Six-Day War? Jerusalem's capital of Israel again. So that's another reason why we study it. It's because it proves itself true. And that leads us into this. The best way to study Revelation. The best way. First of all, and I really do appreciate your point, because we have to realize that I am, and I want you guys to know for a fact, I am not dogmatic about most of the stuff I'm saying. This is my opinion. And as Chuck Missler, who I really love, as Chuck Missler says, this is my opinion. Study it for yourself. Study it for yourself. See if these things be true. And if you come to a different conclusion, that's great. Because I guarantee you, no one's got it 100% right. Chuck doesn't have it 100% right. I don't have it 100% right. Pope doesn't have it 100% right. And no one on this earth has 100% right. We're all going to get to heaven, and we're going to go, wow. So that's what that verse meant. I thought that meant this. Nope. Okay.
But
we're only human. And, you know, my mom gave me a great bit of advice along these lines. About 25, I was a teenager, so it was 30 years ago at least. And I said, and I was reading my Bible, I said, Mom, why didn't God just spell this stuff out? How many extra pages would it have taken to just write this out? She said, would you have studied it then? No, ma'am, I sure would not have. She said, would you have just spent an hour looking at the Word of God if the answer was written out? No. If it was like an owner's manual, how many of you look at the owner's manual? When you get a new whatever, you read that thing. How many of you have an owner's manual in your vehicle? Okay. How many have read it front to back? Not me. Okay. So if it was written like an owner's manual, we wouldn't get the blessing. So the best way to study the book of Revelation is it's worship. When you study the book of Revelation or you approach the Word of God in any way, it should be as worship. And what is worship? What is it literally? What's that word literally mean? Worship.
Communication and praise.
Okay, that's what worship is, but what does the word mean? What's the definition? If I were to look up the Webster's definition of worship, what would it say?
Praying.
Nope.
Humbling means comes to mind. Humbling.
That's what we do in worship, but that's not the definition. The definition is to literally ascribe worth to something. That's what worship means. That's where the word worship means. It means we're ascribing worth. So some of us worship the Dallas Cowboys or football too much because we're ascribing too much worth. Okay, everybody got that? So that's what worship is you, because you can worship anything. It all depends on how much worth you ascribe to it. How much worth do you give it? If you have things in your life and you have to prioritize these things, the thing you worship is what you're giving your top priority to, because you're ascribing more worth to that than anything else. If I am spending more time with my family, which is it's important, but neglecting God and neglecting reading His Word and neglecting spending time with Him in prayer, I'm worshiping my family, because I'm ascribing more worth to them than I am the Creator of the universe. And don't get me wrong, God understands busy lives. All right? How many times did Jesus, in order to get a break, he had to like cut tail and run and go hide in a mountain somewhere? Okay? That's because he had to get along with God. So, you know, you think you got a problem with some kids at the house? Jesus had hundreds of people around him all the time. And he, even being God himself, had to get alone and talk to the Father.
It's interesting that you bring up the Dallas Cowboys and the Dallas worship and games and all of that.
I know, it's very difficult.
Yeah.
It's very difficult, and my phone's right there, and I can't even cheat. But David hasn't run in here screaming or anything, so I'm assuming everything's going okay, because I guarantee you he's looking. I hope he's listening somewhat to the lesson. So, as a book of reconciliation, you need to keep in mind the purpose of the book of Revelation. What's the purpose of Christ on the cross? What did he do? Besides save us from our sins, what was the grand scheme? Was to reconcile us to the Father. To make a way. That's what Jesus did on the cross. Is he reconciled the difference. Because, you know, we're in major debt to the Father because of sin. So he reconciled. Well, the book of Revelation is a book of reconciliation. Because you're under a curse because of sin. And I'm under a curse because of sin. But what else is under a curse because of sin?
Everything.
The ground. The earth. Okay? Animals. They die. They kill each other. Hailstorms comes and ruins my garden. Everything is under a curse because of sin. And what the book of Revelation is a beautiful reconciliation. And that's what the picture is at the end, this all gets reconciled. God gets reconciled and the earth together again. And even with Jesus Christ reigning on the earth for 1,000 years, guess what? Is it still good enough? No. Because even though the devil, and we're going to see this in Revelation 20 and 21 and 22, even though the devil has been in chains for 1,000 years, people will still sin and they will still follow after Satan. With Jesus Christ. Now, we want to know why church people act badly. Okay, why do people do the stupid things they do? Why do they act that way? Let me tell you something. People are still going to act that way with Jesus Christ sitting on the throne. So if you marvel that people act the way they do now, when Jesus is still just, in some minds, an idea, you can't prove him empirically. Okay, can you prove your faith? I think I can prove my faith through certain instances and things that have happened to me. But to the skeptic, you can't prove it. In 1,000-year reign of Christ, yeah, I can prove it. See right over there? He's right there. He's sitting right there. Go touch him. He'll let you touch him. And guess what? They're still going to sin. Because sin is infesting everything. So ultimately, there's a new heavens and a new earth. And that's the total reconciliation. A book of comfort. Revelation is a comforting book. Now, that seems kind of out of whack with the way you may look at Revelation. Because it's scary, right? Yeah, scary. But you have to look at it the way God looks at it. Okay? First of all, can any weapon, Jimmy, can any weapon formed against you prosper? Any weapon of the enemy, that's formed against you, can it prosper according to Scripture?
No.
No. Scripture says no weapon shall formed against you shall prosper.
Well, if you don't believe in God, yeah, a weapon can probably hurt you.
Exactly. Well, God's not talking about a sword. Yeah, if somebody comes, walks up when I go out in the parking lot and shanks me, it's going to hurt. It's a weapon and it's going to hurt me. But what God is talking about is spiritual weapons. All right, because the victory is already yours in Christ. So, it's a book of comfort because ultimately, who's the winner? Christ. It's one of those things where I've read the end of the book. And I am really bad about that, by the way. Whenever we watch something on TV, she will tell you I am the worst that she's ever seen when it comes to surprises. I hate surprises. I hate them. What'd you say? I do. I do. I want to know what I'm getting for Christmas. I had it down to a science when I was a kid. Go ahead.
Gets the X-Acto knife and slices.
No, my mom's scalpels.
My mom's scalpels. Slices the tape right along where it touches, you know, so he can
undo it and look and then take it back to Candy Jones.
You can just slide it out.
That, yeah.
And play with it. You sure can. And I am still.
Oh, he does it to me.
Yes. I'm still that way.
When we first got married, his mom would call and say, "This is what I got for Vanessa for Christmas." As soon as he hangs up the phone, you want to know what she got you? I was like, "No." I couldn't stand it. What is it?
You know, it'd be so easy to set up.
Well, I'm the world's worst when it comes to surprises. So guess what? I've read the back of the book, and I know who wins. And that's comforting to me, that no matter what's going on in my life, no matter how rough it may seem, all right, when I go back to work after being, and I feel so sorry for you, because, you know, I'm lucky to be in the military and have all this leave that I'm burning up right now. And Karen, she's here because this is her one Sunday she's off. And by the way, this is a friend of mine from high school, guys. So,
how come you look so much younger?
He has not aged well.
She has all her hair.
Yeah. Oh, okay, we're moving on. So, no matter how bad my day gets, I can always look at this and go, you know what? I know who wins. Jesus wins. And finally, expect a blessing. Betty, this is the reason why we study it right here. The book of Revelation is the only book in the Bible, as we talked about this last week, that says, read me on special. Blessed is the one who keeps the word of this prophecies. That's in 22:7. And in verse 3 of chapter 1, it said, blessed is the reader of this book. Are you blessed if you read the Psalms? Do you get blessed when you read the Psalms? Okay, when you read the book of Philippians, do you get blessed? I love the book of Philippians. It's probably one of my favorite. Do you see anywhere in there it says, read this book because you're going to get blessed? No. It's assumed. Revelation says, read me, I'm special. You'll get a blessing. Now, I don't know about you guys, but if God says, you know, this particular book, you're going to really be blessed. I know you're going to be blessed by everything else. That's a given. But this one, that is a clue to me that I probably ought to look at it. Even if it's confusing, even if I don't understand it, there's a blessing. And even if I will never figure out anything about it, God can't lie. And if he says it's going to bless me, somehow it's going to bless me. So that's the reason why we study it.
Can I say something?
Yes, ma'am.
You know how many times
and that is an excellent point, because I have used prophecy to lead. I've explained my friend Jeff Goldman. When we first met 28 years ago, he did not even believe in God. He went through a period of agnosticism. And now he is a firm believer in the Old Testament. He's Jewish from New York. Okay, he is a New York City Jew. All your stereotypes from Queens
are true.
Mm-hmm. All right? But he will tell you that these things are going to happen because the Bible says it. And it wasn't me reading the book of John to him. It wasn't me reading, you know, John 3:16. It was Old Testament prophecy that won him over. Because I would tell him, well, this and that and this and that. And because he would call me and say, you know, I think this is going to happen. They're going to do this and this and that. And I was like, hey, read. He goes, and I tell you what, Syria is in real trouble. I said, hey, why don't you read Isaiah 17? I'm going to send you the verse. I'd send it to him. He'd read it. He goes, wow, Damascus will be a ruinous heap. Because that's what he'd been saying. I think they're just going to level them. It was prophecy. Now, we haven't got him to Christ yet, but he is a lot closer than he ever has been. He's just one step. He even believes in the authority of the Word of God better than some people who claim they're Christians. Because I've showed him Psalm 83 and Ezekiel 37 and 38 and Isaiah 17 and all sorts of Old Testament prophecies and stuff in the New Testament. And he's just like, wow, this is true. And we're sitting at a restaurant one night, and a buddy of mine is talking about Hiro. He's talking about all these things going on. And Jeff breaks out. And at first, I thought he was mocking me. And then I realized he wasn't. He said, no, that's going to happen. The Bible says it. And I almost went, all right, you don't have to. But I realized, because I've known him for 28 years, he was serious. Yeah, that's going to happen. They're going to go down because the Bible says it. It's in what chapter was that, Nelson? And I went, oh, yeah, that's Ezekiel 38, 39. He goes, yeah, it's going to happen. You watch. And I went, ooh. So there's the book of Revelation. These are a word picture of the book of Revelation. So you want to know what emphasis is on a book? You look at a word picture because the size of the word represents how many times it's used. So you can see the first and foremost thought about the book of Revelation is God. Great. The earth. Heaven. Seven. We're going to talk about that number. Angels. The beast. So that's a word picture. So there are 404 verses in the book of Revelation. There are 800 allusions to the Old Testament. So when it's confusing to you, and I'm saying this as gentle as possible because it applied to me at one point in my Christian walk and still applies to me somewhat today. I have been on an Old Testament tear the last several months. If things are confusing to you in the book of Revelation, it's because you haven't done your homework in the Old Testament. Plain and simple. You haven't connected the dots. All right? When the book of Revelation talks about the four beasts, okay? Anybody know what that's out of?
Ezekiel
chapter 1. If you're like, what are these beasts? All you got to do is read Ezekiel chapter 1 where he sees his vision of a wheel inside of a wheel and a flame and this and that. There's the beast right there. They're the same beast. Okay? It's right there. And that's just one of them. We haven't done our homework in the Old Testament. So, John wrote it on the Isle of Patmos on the Lord's Day. And in 95 AD. And remember I was telling you about we think that it's 95 AD and not 70 AD. Because if it's pre-70 AD, then that means that the preterist view may hold water. But we know that it's not. Because we have an Old Testament scholar, not an Old Testament scholar, excuse me, Eusebius. He's an early church historian. He's one of the early church fathers, theologian. He said, can you give me a little water?
Yeah.
That's all right. He said that John wrote it. Now, who are you going to believe? A guy that was discipled by a guy who was discipled by John, so basically a grandson of John, or some guy 2,000 years later who didn't have firsthand knowledge? Who are you going to go with? You going to go with the guy that was there, or the guy who sits 2,000 years like Hank Hinegraaff out of time? I'm going to go with this guy. And this guy says in his writings in the second century that John was sent there by the Emperor Domitian in 95 AD. And he was there a year and a half. That's history. So, he's on Patmos, and he says, write what you see in a book to the seven churches, and there they are. So he is sitting right over here on this little island, penal colony. Why was he on the penal colony? Anybody remember? Besides preaching the Word of God, we know that. But what did they try to do to him? They had tried to kill him several times. They tried to burn him in oil. Boiling oil, they stuck him in there, he wouldn't die. They couldn't kill him. They tried to do all sorts of things. It wasn't his time. You need to know that if it ain't your time, it ain't your time. And when it is your time, it is your time. Ain't nothing you can do Jesus said there ain't nothing you can do to prolong an hour. So if I drop dead tomorrow, it was my time. The Bible says it's appointed for a man who wants to die. That appointment, there's an appointment. And unlike your doctor, this doctor isn't late for his. All right? Okay? When I went to Iraq back in 2003,
She just knew I was going to die. She just knew it. And I said, and it was a moment of inspiration from the Lord, I believe, because it comforted her, and she never had a doubt again. I said, honey, if you think I'm going to die over there, and we had already worked on ministry, we were going to plant a church, we had done a lot of groundwork, and the Lord had done some amazing things to line all this out. And I said, honey, if you think I'm going to die over there, and what you're saying is my appointed time to die, and that God is through with my ministry. Did you ever have a moment's doubt after that? Nope.
I didn't even cry. I mean, I cried when you left, but every time somebody would ask me, at the time we were at First Baptist Rosario, where Chuck was, and every time people would come up and go, I don't know how you're doing this, I don't know how you're getting through this, and I'm like, or they asked me when he's coming back. I said, I don't know when he's coming back, because he was supposed to be gone a year. And he wasn't, but he was supposed to be gone a year, and I said, I don't know when
up
he's coming
to 2 years.
But I know he's coming back. And I never was not scared at all, even after some of the emails I read, I wasn't scared. So.
Yeah, I let one slip. We got
to your mom, not to me.
I thought it was
No, I read it on her computer.
Oh yeah. Well, it had a huge explosion go off right outside my office. And the way it worked was our nighttime was their daytime, vice versa. So, and I was the night shift NCOIC, so I'm, you know, being a weather guy and, you know, forecasting for these guys, I have to have communications. I can't, you know, if we're inserting special operations troops, so, you know, the Jessica Lynch rescue, I actually was on that, believe it or not. Funny story about that. She goes, you were on the Jessica Lynch mission? I went, how do you know that? She goes, it's in your citation. I went, oh, I guess it's declassified now. Because I didn't know. So I'm sitting there typing. And all of a sudden, just boom, and the whole thing shook, and I'm like, what is, and I hear all this, you know, gunfire and everything, and all I typed was, big bang, big boom, gotta go, and I left it like that.
No, big explosion, big, lots of fire.
Oh, that's right, that's right.
And this was like the day before he flew home,
that,
so
that
I'm like,
that brightened her up a line a little bit.
It's not real good operational security either.
Oh, he's got a picture of it.
I do have a picture of it. I'll show it to you after. I have a picture of it going off. So anyway, those are the seven churches. And we have a nice, they're in a nice, you know, and some of them are still towns in Turkey. They've changed the names. But they're still there. These towns are still there. So, John's on Patmos. We talked about why that was important. The why is because God's got him alone. He's by himself. But we know he's on Patmos, and the reason why is because we now know that all that stuff that happened in 70 AD, that's not what he's talking about. And what Jesus is talking about in Matthew 24 and in Luke 13, I'm sorry, Mark 13 and Luke 21, we know that because of the similarities that Jesus can't be talking about what happens in 70 AD. Because John is talking about it too 25 years later. So that's why it's important. So it's also important to study Revelation. Because we need to know, just like John, that all those who desire to live godly lives in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. And memorize this verse and take it as fact. As we're reading through the book of Acts as a family, think back to Acts chapter 4 when the disciples were beaten for preaching the name of Christ. What did they do? After they were beaten and released, what did they do? They filed a lawsuit? No lawsuits. Did they seek legal counsel even? No. Did they plot revenge? Did they arm up? Did they stockpile some weapons? What did they do? They rejoiced. They're like, wow, I can't believe we were so worthy to be beaten for Christ. Now that concept is lost on us as Americans. But you need to remember that even as I speak right now, there are people in this world are living out this principle. And it ain't because they don't have guns, right? It's because they're being persecuted for the name of Christ. There's a difference in defending your family and defending your faith. You need to know that. Yes, that's right. That's right. In Iran, right? Iran. Okay? If you're not being persecuted in some form or fashion, and it doesn't have to be on a daily basis, but if you're not suffering some kind of persecution, you're not living your faith right. Because I guarantee you, it's tough to look somebody in the eye and say, oh, you're crazy. I don't believe that. One of my best friends that just passed away. An atheist. All right? He used to do stuff all the time, and it wasn't physical. And you know, it doesn't have to be physical. It can be emotional. All right? But you need to understand that it's not your right as a Christian to live a persecution-free life. If it was good enough for John and Peter and Paul to go through this, what makes you think you were so special to not have to? So as we go through these latter days, we have to remember that. And I am fully prepared. And many of you have said the same thing, I'm sure. I'm fully prepared to give my life for Christ. And if somebody wants to come drag me out of my house because of my faith in Christ, not because they want to take my food or kill my family, but if they want to take me out and put me in a public square because of my faith in Christ, I'm not firing the first bullet. They can do it. Because if Paul was drug out and had, I mean, let's even go Jesus.
Jesus.
Peter tried. Now, he didn't have an SAS or an AK, you know. He had a sword. And Jesus, like, put it away. And then he undid his actions. So memorize that verse. The audience. So the audience of the book of Revelation, there are seven churches. And we have, blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy. And blessed are those that hear. And blessed are those that keeps what's written in it, for the time is near. So that's the audience. The audience is the seven churches, and the audience is the one who's reading and hearing. So that is everyone who has ever read the book of Revelation. If you've read the book of Revelation, you're the audience. You're the intended audience. That's what the Bible says. Next, I want to talk about what's called a heptadic structure. Anybody know, besides Mark, anybody know what the heptadic structure is? I know you do. And this is a common theme, is it not? I mean, you're going to see this over and over again. It's crazy.
Well, hept means seven. So sevens.
There you go. Give that woman a cookie. All right.
She's a math teacher.
No fair. No fair. Cheater, cheater, cheater. Okay. Heptadic structure, what you're going to see in the book of Revelation, is seven. It's all over the place. This is a short list of the sevens. You're not going to be able to write all of this down, but I ain't going to stay here that long. But this is a short list of the sevens. If you want to just, we got seven churches, you got seven lampstands, you got seven seals, you got seven trumpets, you got seven vials, you got seven heads, and 10 horns on the seven heads. You got seven hills on which the woman sits. You've got all sorts of stuff. That is 7, 7, 7, 7, 7. And somebody has calculated, matter of fact, for a doctoral thesis, or dissertation, I'm sorry, somebody actually compiled up a list of the heptadic structure of the book of Revelation, and has found over 200. And it's not just lists. It's 200 times that something is said. There's seven thunders. You know, God is funny. And if you read the book of Revelation, you'll see in chapter 10, verses 3 and 4, that there's seven thunders that speak. And John says, and I heard these seven thunders, and I was just about to write it down, and God said, nope, don't write it down. And I'm like, what is it? I want to know. But you know what? There's going to come a time. And that's what we have to remember about Revelation. Revelation is going to be a roadmap for people who are in the tribulation. If that's us, for, you know, if we're not pre-trib rapture for some reason we're pre-wrath, Revelation, we talked about knowledge increasing. You have no idea what work the Holy Spirit's going to do. If we do happen to get into that time, God is going to be revealing things, and we're all going to be walking around going, why did we not see that? But if we are gone, for those who are left, they're going to be able to look at the book of Revelation. It is going to become so crystal clear to them. They're going to see it unfold before their eyes. When these vials are pulled out, or these trumpets are sounded, or these bowls are poured out, and the seals are broken, they're going to go, okay, well, that was that one. And so now we know we've got 5 months, like the locusts. Okay, so we know that just started today, so that's going to stop in February. You're going to be able to do that. It's going to be amazing. So there's all the sevens that I wanted to list. There literally are hundreds. Seven, and we're going to actually look at some of those. There's seven title pairs, seven promises. And a lot of these are in these first three chapters, and we're really going to look at those. So, whose revelation is it? Okay. Go back and let's look at verse. Go back to chapter 1, verse 1. Whose revelation is it?
Jesus
Christ. Who gave it to him? God. To show to his servants the thing that must soon take place. Now, this is another one of those things that you have to know the Greek. If I were to say something were to soon take place, what is that? What do you assume is going to happen?
Something's going to happen right away.
Right away. Mm-hmm. Guess what? That's not what the Greek word means. Mm-hmm. Jimmy, if I were to say tachometer to you, what does that mean? And if you don't know it, I'm sure Ted will help you.
That's an instrument that shows you the RPM.
Okay. And so what's it registering?
Revolutions.
Revolutions. It's the quickness of the engine. That is the word that's used in the Greek for soon. So what it actually means is that once they start to take place, it's going to really go fast. It has, because of the way the Greek structure is, it doesn't mean soon as in relation to me, my point of view. It means when it happens, it's gonna rev up, like a tachometer does. You know, you see it go to the red line. That's what the Greek word is. It's tachios, and that's where we get the word tachometer from. So anytime you see the Lord comes quickly, it doesn't mean he's coming. If I tell Vanessa she's out the store, and this has happened so many times in our marriage, so it's a really good thing.
Nice. Come on home, Vanessa, he's coming.
Everybody knows how men and women shop, right? Okay, so here you are, the entrance of the store, and you need this. Men do this, and women do, you know.
Oh, hi, how you doing?
Okay, there I go. Right?
My break from you.
Oh! Zingbot! Zingbot! No, you're not. She's break from me and the kids, probably. I'm like, why'd you go camp out at the store? You just said you were going to get milk, and it's an hour and a half later, and Kroger's only like a half a mile away. I mean, it's not like you had to go to Amarillo. So when I say quickly, that's right, she needs a break. When I say quickly, come home quickly, that means that I need her home right now. But in the Greek, and when you read this in the scripture, because Jesus is coming quickly, it doesn't mean quickly as in get here now. It means that when things start to happen, it's going to be quick. Not going to be a lot of dilly-dallying around. All right? So.
My husband called it procrastination.
Yeah, we just call it shopping. So, descriptions of Christ. Let's talk real quick about the descriptions of Christ. Who is, and who was, and who is to come. In verse 5, He's called the faithful witness. He's the firstborn of the dead. He's the ruler of the kings of the earth. He is him who loves us. Him who has freed us from our sins by his blood. That's who this revelation is by. And it's also he who made us a kingdom of priests to his God and Father. Remember the priesthood of the believers. You are part of the priesthood. It is not those of us who have been ordained and who... And by the way, I do not use the label reverend. I despise it because there's nothing holy about me. There's nothing to be revered about me. And so therefore, I don't use it. And besides, Peter says that we're all part of the priesthood. We all took the place of the Levites. So he has made us part of the kingdom, and we are kings and priests. He's in the midst of the lampstands. Lampstands. What does a lampstand do? Okay, does it? A lampstand. Okay, it supports a light. So he is in the midst of the lampstands, and the lampstands are the churches. Okay? So the lampstands aren't the light. They're what hold the light. All right? That's very important to remember. You see that he is the Son of Man, which is the Messiah. All right? We see that he has a long robe. This is in verse 13. That is a symbol of his rank and his role as the high priest. Remember what Hebrews talks about? We do not have a high priest who is not unfamiliar with our infirmities and our afflictions, etc., etc. We have a high priest who basically was like us. He is now the high priest. He took the place of the high priestly order. He has a sash of gold. That is symbolic of his regal rank, his kingly rank. And many times in the Old Testament, especially it talks about David, you'll see he had a golden sash. That means that he was the king. So not only is he the head priest, he is the head king. So he is the head of the kingdom and the priesthood. And real quickly, and you guys can sort this out. Revelation verses 14 through 16. There are 7 descriptions of Christ in that passage of Scripture. We see what his hair is like. We see what his eyes are like. We see what his feet are like. We hear what his voice is like. We see what's in his right hand. We see what's in his mouth. And we look at his countenance, his face. And we see that it's white like wool. It's like a flame of fire. He's burnished bronze, refined in the furnace. And these are all, here we go. Here are all these Old Testament descriptions. You have some out of Isaiah, some out of Ezekiel and Daniel, even Numbers. Anybody remember the bronze serpent in Numbers where Israel had sinned and Moses had to stick the fiery serpent, the bronze serpent, and they had to look on the serpent to be healed from being bitten by serpents? Well, we see that his feet are made of that same bronze. My personal favorite description of God is found in Daniel 7:9. The Ancient of Days. I can't read that without getting choked up. I can't even hear it. I don't know what it is about that particular phrase. And guess what? Everybody's got their own. You've got your own word that you like about God. It may say that he is my comforter because he may have comforted you in a time in your life when you really needed it. You may say he is my healer because there was a time when you were sick and you knew God healed you. There's all sorts of different aspects about God. But for me, that word, that phrase, Ancient of Days, it to me reveals so much about who God is. And his voice is like the roar of many waters. And if you've ever been around waterfalls, you know, a big waterfall, you can hear it. You can hear it for ways away. You know, I think of Multnomah Falls in Oregon, right outside of Portland. It's about a 700 and something foot waterfall. I don't even know how many times we've been there. But you get in the parking lot and you're still about a mile away and you can hear it. It's just like this roar. And it just echoes. So these are the seven descriptions of Christ. And I want to finish with looking at the way the book is divided. There's three divisions. There's that which was. In other words, this is past tense, chapter 1. And the reason why it's past tense in chapter 1, because it's talking about Jesus, and Jesus has always been this way. He ain't changed. That which is. That which is what's going on right now. That's chapters 2 and chapter 3. That's present in the context of John writing the scripture. That was what was going on in the seven churches. And what is to come. And that is chapter 4 and on. And we're just now getting there in Sunday school. Where we're just now getting to what's going on in the future. And the reason why we've taken such a long time and why we will take such a long time is you need to get these foundations. You've got to get the foundations before you can get to knowing just the future stuff. Because a lot of the blessing comes from knowing, when we get into the churches next week, and we're going to take those kind of slow, that Church of Ephesus, when you really look at all those seven churches and what's being said to them, what their admonishments are, what their praises are, you know, God says, hey, you guys are doing a real good job in this area, and you guys are stinkers in this area. All right? And there's five churches that are given condemnations. And only two churches are said, you know what, I ain't got nothing to say bad about you guys. And then there are five churches which there's praises given, but there's two churches that there's no praise. He goes, I don't have anything good to say about you. And you can really apply the lessons of those churches to your life. Because, for instance, the Church of Ephesus, it reminds me a lot of a good old Southern Baptist church. They're very actively involved in doing good things. That's what Jesus is saying to the Church of Ephesus. You guys, hey, and your benevolence ministry is spot on. You have great fellowships. You got some good food going on. But you have forgotten one thing. What is it, Brenda? Your first love. You've gotten so busy with the stuff, you forgot about your devotion to me. And I think if we look back on our lives individually, every one of us has probably been at some point where we were real active in church. We're doing the kids ministry, and we're doing the bus ministry, and we're doing that ministry and this ministry, and we're here every time the doors are open. But if you looked at our prayer life and our Bible study time, you would see it was anemic. And when it all comes down to it, the prayer time and the Bible study time is when we get to know who Jesus is. We can kind of get a glimpse of who Jesus is by being around our brothers and sisters and partaking of fellowship and stuff like that. But until you get into here, you are not going to know the heart of your Lord. And that's what Jesus is saying to the Church of Ephesus, is evaluate your devotion. You guys are real good about doing all these great things for people, but you have left your first love. You don't ever spend any time with me anymore. You know, we've known people, and I know you have too, who were so involved in church that their marriage suffered. Okay, they were so active in doing, they were on every committee, and they were on every time the door were open, either he or she were working. They were at meetings every night of the week at a church because they were on this committee and this thing and that thing and had to teach this class and do that thing. But they never spent any time together. So they had sacrificed their devotion for each other, for work. And the Lord says, when it comes to me, that is not supposed to be. So that's what we got coming up, is we're going to look at the churches. and we're going to see how do they apply to us. And that's 7 o'clock. So, right on the nose. So, any questions? How many, what's the number in a Book of Revelation? What's the structure?
Seven.
Heptatic. All right. For next week, read chapter 2. Read chapter 2 again. And you guys are going to read these chapters over and over and over again. It's a real short chapter. You're looking at I think 4 letters in that chapter. So just start looking at that. Maybe read chapter 1 again too. And if you really want something to do, go back and look at all the descriptions of Jesus. And try to think about maybe why did they go into such detail? You know, why is Jesus revealing himself like this in that passage of scripture in Revelation 1? What's the point? Because there is a point. Is there a point for everything in the Word of God? There's a reason why every word's there. God didn't just fill some filler. He said, well, I need a sentence because I want this chapter to be a little longer. He didn't do it that way. Every word's important. All right? All right, let's go to the Word of Prayer. Father, we are just so thankful for your blessings. Lord, we're so thankful for the Book of Revelation. And Lord, as we go through this time, I pray you will just bless our reading. Lord, as we look at your book again, the last book in our canon of Scripture, Father, I pray that you would just use your Holy Spirit to guide us. And Lord, as these men and women, as they read the Word of God, your Word this week, Father, I pray that you would enlighten them. Father, give them understanding in maybe an area that they are curious about or have never understood. Father, I pray that this week would be the week that they would go back and look at it again, and that you would shine the light of your understanding into their hearts. And Father, may it always be so that when we look at your Word, we allow the Holy Spirit to teach us. Father, help us to not rely on the counsel of men, but your counsel. Because Father, that is the true amazing thing, Lord, about you. That Father, I can read a passage of Scripture, and that everyone here can read a passage of Scripture, and it may touch us in a different way because you are a God that does that. You're just amazing. And Father, we give you praise and we give you thanks. In Christ's name, amen. Amen.